Subcommittee on the Constitution and Civil Justice will come to order. Without objection, the chair is authorized to declare recesses of the committee at any time. Pursuant to notice, I now call up for consideration the Subcommittee on the Constitution and Civil Justice's Rules of Procedure for Private Claims Bills. And I will now recognize myself for a brief opening statement, and then I will recognize the ranking member. The Judiciary Committee has jurisdiction over legislation related to claims against the United States, including private claims bills. Within the committee for this Congress, jurisdiction over claims against the United States and private claims bills has been shifted from the Immigration Subcommittee to the Constitution Subcommittee. Accordingly, we have called today's meeting so that this subcommittee can adopt the same rules of procedure for private claims bills that the Immigration Subcommittee adopted in previous Congresses when it had jurisdiction over such bills. Private claims bills arise when citizens request individualized relief from Congress when administrative or other legal remedies have been exhausted. Until the early 1970s, Congress regularly granted relief through private legislation, but as Congress has expanded administrative discretion to deal with many of the situations that tended to give rise to private bills, such bills have become much more rare. In considering whether to grant relief through a private claims bill, the subcommittee's task is to determine whether the entities and circumstances or the equities and circumstances create a moral obligation on the part of the federal government to extend individual relief. These rules of procedure will guide our consideration of private claims bills to help ensure that only truly meritorious claims are reported favorably from the committee. There are 15 proposed rules of procedure. The rules include provisions such as not giving consideration to a private bill until the subcommittee has received sufficient evidence, not considering any claim that accrued more than 15 years before the first session of the current Congress convenes, and not considering any claim over which another tribunal, court, or department has jurisdiction until all remedies under such jurisdiction are exhausted. The rules of procedure establish the standard requirements for the consideration of private claims bills. Without these standards, Congress could potentially be inundated with the requests from and for private relief. These procedural rules served the Immigration Committee well in the past, and I would recommend that we adopt them for the 114th Congress. And I would now recognize the ranking member for any statement that he may have.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to commend you on your opening statement, on your rules, on your position, and look forward to working with you in a bipartisan fashion.
That's a first. Copies of the proposed rules are before each member. Without objection, the rules will be considered as read and open for amendment at any point. Are there any amendments? He must have been telling the truth. If there are no amendments, the question is on adopting the rules of procedure for private claims bills. And since there is not a quorum at the present moment, we will be postponing this vote. And we will now turn to our next order of business, our hearing on First Amendment protections on public colleges and university campuses. We want to welcome all the witnesses here and all the audience here today. June is a graduation season for many colleges and universities across America. It is a time of reflection as these graduates take what they've experienced in college and go off to pursue their own happiness in a world that consists of people of different views, perspectives, philosophies, and beliefs. So it's timely that today's hearing is about protecting students' constitutional rights on public colleges and university campuses, particularly the rights to free expression and association. The First Amendment of the Constitution provides that it prohibits the government, including governmental entities such as public colleges and universities, from encroaching on free speech and the free exercise of religion. The First Amendment of the United States of America clearly states, quote, "Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging freedom of speech, or of the press, or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble," unquote. Yet regarding free speech, the American Association of Colleges and Universities found In a 2010 survey of 24,000 college students, that only 36% strongly agreed with the following statement that, quote, it is safe to hold unpopular views on campus, unquote. Of 9,000 campus professionals, only 19% agreed with the same statement. And as students progress toward their senior year, they become even more doubtful that it is safe to hold unpopular views on campuses. We should all let that sink in for a moment. According to the American Association of College and Universities own survey, an overwhelming majority of students and faculty were not confident that it was safe to hold unpopular views on campus. Regarding religious liberty, one of our witnesses today, Greg Lukianoff, in his book, Unlearning Liberty, Campus Censorship and the End of American Debates, writes, quote, while it sometimes seems that there is no rhyme or reason to what can get a student group in trouble on campus, certain trends emerge over time. In particular, the fundamental misunderstanding of tolerance and freedom of association that is widely applied to evangelical Christian groups. If you told me 12 years ago that I, a liberal atheist, would devote a sizable portion of my career to Christian groups, I might have been surprised. But almost from my first day at the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, I was shocked to realize how badly Christian groups are often treated, unquote. Indeed, a survey conducted by the Institute for Jewish and Community Research showed that the only group that a majority of the faculty were comfortable admitting that they evoked strong negative feelings in them were evangelical Christians. According to a 2015 report published by the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, 55% of the 437 colleges and universities they examined, quote, maintain policies that seriously infringe upon the free speech rights of students, unquote. 55%. That's a pretty shocking number. With very few and very narrow exceptions, the Supreme Court has declared that the government cannot regulate speech based on its content. The court has stated that above all else, the First Amendment means that government has no power to restrict expression because of its message, its ideas, its subject matter, or its content. This core principle is neither conservative nor liberal. Indeed, it is to the mutual benefit of all to oppose the silencing of others. As Thomas Paine stated in his Dissertations on First Principles of Government, quote, he that would make his own liberty secure must guard even his enemy from opposition. For if he violates this duty, he establishes a precedent that will reach to himself, unquote. Thomas Jefferson stated it another way, but even more directly, when he said, quote, I have sworn upon the altar of God eternal hostility against every form of tyranny over the mind of man, unquote. A nation of free people must be vigilant of government encroachment on unpopular thought. We must be particularly vigilant to protect the freedom of religious exercise, since it is a cornerstone of all other freedoms. Today in America, we face the very real danger of allowing students at our public colleges and universities to graduate without experiencing what it is that makes us truly free as Americans. Whether on college campuses or anywhere else across this nation, it is our undeniable and sworn duty to guard those sacred First Amendment rights contained in our Constitution for our young and for all Americans, and to make sure that we pass them along intact for all American generations to come. Now, before I yield to the ranking member for an opening statement, I think now we're ready for the vote. Is that right? All right, so then forgive me if you'll do the drum roll, as you say. The question is on the adoption of the rules of procedure for private claims bills. All in those in favor will signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed will say no. Looks like we squeaked through it, and the ayes have it. And the Subcommittee on the Constitution and Civil Justice Rules of Procedure for Private Claims Bills are adopted. Do we need? So now, before I yield to the ranking member for an opposing statement, I would first like to show a short Fox and Friends interview with student Bianca Travis, who is the president of a Christian student group that this year lost its official status at California State University because the group requires student leaders to hold the same religious beliefs as the organization. Will the folks go ahead and start?
For violating the school's discrimination policy. The group's offense, requiring its leaders to also be Christian. So is it actually the university that's doing the discrimination? Joining us now is the president of Chi Alpha chapter at Cal State, Bianca Davis. Bianca, thanks for being with us on Fox and Friends Weekend.
Thank you for having me.
I'm confused. I mean, how could somebody be an effective leader of a Christian group on campus if they're not a Christian? I mean, don't you study scripture? Don't you go over Bible quotes? You do a lot more than just helping out on campus. It's more than service-based. It is religion-based, isn't it?
Yes. Yes, absolutely. We lead Bible studies, we lead worship services and prayer, and I don't see how anyone could effectively lead the group if they don't follow those beliefs. For instance, how could someone lead you into a prayer, into a God that they don't even believe in? And that's why we feel like this is so unfair, and how it doesn't make sense how anyone could try to lead a group that they don't believe their mission.
Do you see this rule as being flawed from all angles? I mean, I don't understand how a man, for example, could lead a female sorority, or how an F student could be the leader of an honor society of some sort on campus. Do you see this as discrimination against Christianity as a whole? Is this part of the war on Christianity?
Well, I do feel like we're treated unfairly. I feel like the just religious groups in general on campus, I feel like this whole idea to bring diversity on a college campus, going about it this way is actually driving religious groups out and diminishing the diversity on our campus. And I don't feel like that attending a college university should cost me my faith.
Yeah, especially on this Palm Sunday, it's really resonating with a lot of our viewers. Want to get out a statement from the Vice President, Tim Lynch, of Cal State. He says, what they cannot be is faith-based, where someone has to have a profession of faith to be that leader. Every club is allowed to establish its own standards for how leaders are selected, as long as it's non-discriminatory. So you are trying to work with the university. Do you feel like they're budging on this at all?
I don't think they're budging at all. We had meeting after meeting with them, and they refused to put anything in writing. And at one point, they told us that they're done playing games with us, and they no longer want to work with us about this. And so I feel like we've done everything we can, and I just really want to be a part of the campus community. We have lost so many opportunities to reach our campus and be a part of the campus community and be a part of the school that we love in general.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like you're playing games. You're talking about your faith here, and really it's the university that's missing out. You've had to cancel 15 previously approved events, including helping out at graduation. So the entire university potentially is missing out on this, not just people in your club. Bianca Travis, thank you so much for standing up for your faith this morning.
And I would first thank the ranking member for his indulgence, and I would now yield to Mr. Cohen from Tennessee for his opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. It's normally only when I'm at the doctor's office that I have to watch Fox, but it's free speech. And I want to commend you for having two ACLU-connected people as witnesses on the Republican side. This is indeed a first.
You got three.
Two that they've chosen. Or we could say three, and that makes it for a better story. I've been a long supporter of the First Amendment and the ACLU, and the First Amendment's right to free speech, as well as its other rights. I sponsored the Speech Act, which became law. Chairman Franks co-sponsored it, and President Obama signed it into law, and it required American courts to deny recognition or enforcement of foreign defamation judgments that did not comport with our First Amendment speech protections. It would be difficult for anybody to think back upon the 60s and 70s, to where so much happened in our country that was revolutionary in a way, concerning Vietnam and civil rights, where free speech wasn't a part of the discourse by college and university students. Freedom to speak was vital to the anti-Vietnam War, pro-civil rights, other social justice movements of the time. And those sentiments were, at the time, unpopular or offensive to some listeners, but they led to a change for the better in our society. I share the basic commitment that all of our witnesses have to open inquiry and the free and vigorous exchange of ideas that is the hallmark of higher education. And I share the skepticism that any First Amendment defender feels toward government attempts to limit speech on the base of its offensiveness. It's not a coincidence that most of the Supreme Court's decisions governing the First Amendment scope today concern speech or expressive conduct that would be offensive to many listeners. Such unpopular speech is exactly the kind the First Amendment is meant to protect, and there's no surprise the court has protected things like flag burning, insensitive protests at military funerals, and clothing with expletives written on them worn in open court. At the same time, I'm sympathetic to the concerns animating the promulgation of anti-harassment policies at universities. These concerns are not hypothetical. Rather, real harassment on the basis of race, gender, religion, ethnicity, and sexual orientation is a problem. I've read about and heard about problems at UCLA. Miss Beta wanted to be on this college group, and the board didn't vote her on because she was Jewish, assuming that she wasn't going to vote like they wanted her to vote on divestment of investments with Israel. This was a difficult thing. UCLA, you wouldn't think would happen at UCLA, but it did. In fact, anti-Semitism is prevalent on many campuses, and maybe people don't even understand sometimes when they are being anti-Semitic. According to the National Demographic Survey of American Jewish College Students conducted by researchers at Trinity College, 54% of Jewish students reported experiencing anti-Semitism on campus in the first 6 months of the 2013-14 school year. 54% anti-Semitism in the first 6 months. This follows a 2013 Pew Research Center report that found 22% of younger Jewish Americans reported being called an offensive name based on their Jewish identity. According to the American Association of University Women, 80% of female college students report having been sexually harassed at their school by a peer, and 25% of men admitted targeting others with homophobic slurs. According to another study, 20% of the college students surveyed said that harassment caused inability to concentrate in class, and 23% said it prevented them from even attending class. Part of the problem is a lack of student body diversity. According to a study in the Chronicle of Higher Education, the less diverse the student body, the higher the percentage of minority students who report experiencing discrimination, with more than 60% reporting such discrimination at the least diverse schools. Great support for public education. Notwithstanding the existence of civil rights laws that are designed to address harassment on the basis of protected characteristic, harassment that interferes with students' right to a safe learning environment remains a very real concern. Too often, the need for a vigorous defense of free speech values results in dismissing or minimizing some legitimate concerns motivating attempts to regulate verbal conduct. This is not to justify in any way overly broad, vague, or subjective policies that sweep in protected speech in the name of addressing harassment. But the challenge for the First Amendment's defenders is to ensure that pure harassment is deterred and punished while at the same time staying true to our constitutional values. So a very difficult subject. Chair, I concur with some of the statements made about the in the broadcast by the student, and it would be difficult for somebody who doesn't believe to be the leader of that group. But times, they are changing, and indeed we can see possibly where a man could lead a sorority, but that's another issue. I yield back the balance of my time.
Probably be plenty of volunteers. And with that, I thank the gentleman, and I would yield to the chairman of the Judiciary Committee, Mr. Goodlatte from Virginia.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to welcome all of today's witnesses. According to the Department of Education, about 21 million students were expected to attend a college or university in 2014. And according to the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, about 70% of high school graduates in 2014 were enrolled in colleges or universities. As more and more young people go to college, they will be exposed to and shaped by campus policies, including policies regulating speech. But what effect will that have? Research shows that young adults are often less tolerant of free speech than older generations. The results of overly restrictive campus speech policies are noted with increasing frequency in the press. On September 17, 2013, for example, a student at a community college in California was barred by administrators from distributing copies of the United States Constitution because the student didn't seek prior permission. He was also told that such activity must be performed in a narrowly designated free speech zone. Administrators at a public university in Alabama, according to a complaint filed in federal court by Alliance Defending Freedom, denied a student group's request in 2013 and 2014 to set up a pro-life display in an area commonly used by other groups for expressive activities. Instead, according to the complaint, university administrators insisted they congregate in a narrowly designated free speech zone because the group advocates for a position that involves political and social controversy. A student in Texas recently filed a suit against her public college because she and a classmate were displaying signs supporting the Second Amendment when they were approached by a campus official and three police officers and told they couldn't hold the signs again in the public area without special permission. The official had apparently received complaints that their signs were offensive. There are many, many more examples in the huge volume of personal accounts coming from our nation's public colleges and universities is disturbing. The Foundation for Individual Rights in Education alone lists on its website nearly 390 reported cases of speech violations. Given that more than half of American colleges and universities maintain what appear to be unconstitutional speech policies, no doubt many, many more cases of free speech infringement have gone unreported. Policies that limit free speech limit the expression of ideas. And no one can be confident in their own ideas unless those ideas are constantly tested through exposure to the widest variety of opposing arguments. This is especially crucial in a democracy. The founders of our country understood this clearly. George Washington and Thomas Jefferson wrote of the importance of knowledge in a democracy. Washington wrote, "Knowledge is in every country the surest basis of public happiness. In proportion as the structure of government gives force to public opinion, it is essential that public opinion should be enlightened." And as Thomas Jefferson reminded us, knowledge is power. If a nation expects to be ignorant and free in a state of civilization, it expects what never was and never will be. James Madison wrote the inherent connection between free speech, learning, and liberty, writing, and I quote, "What spectacle can be more edifying or more seasonable than that of liberty and learning, each leaning on the other for their mutual and surest support? A popular government without popular information or the means of acquiring it is but a prologue to a farce or a tragedy, or perhaps both. And a people who mean to be their own governors must arm themselves with the power which knowledge gives." John Adams wrote specifically of the young, writing that, "It should be your care, therefore, and mine, to elevate the minds of our children and exalt their courage. If we suffer their minds to grovel and creep in infancy, they will grovel all their lives." This is an important topic about one of our fundamental freedoms as Americans. I thank Chairman Franks for holding this hearing, and I thank our witnesses for coming today. I look forward to your testimony.
And I thank the chairman, and I would now yield to the ranking member of the committee, Mr. Conyers from Michigan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I too welcome the witnesses and appreciate the importance of this hearing, entitled First Amendment Protections on Public College and University Campuses. Today's hearing gives us an opportunity to consider the important issue of how best to ensure the protection of fundamental constitutional rights for college and university students while also protecting them from hateful and demeaning harassment. To begin with, harassment and intimidation based on race, sex, religion, sexual orientation remains a serious problem on campuses today. Hostility against racial and religious minorities, women and lesbian, gay, and transgender students remains all too common. Despite decades of efforts aimed at combating discrimination. Just a few months ago, a video surfaced of a group of white fraternity members at the University of Oklahoma singing a horribly racist song, one that repeatedly used the N-word and referred to hanging African Americans from a tree. To understand the kind of climate on campuses that many minority students face and that university administrators must address. According to the American Association of University Women, 62% of female college students report having been sexually harassed at their university, and 80% of that harassment committed by a peer. The same study also revealed that 51% of male college students admitted to sexually harassing someone in college, with 22% acknowledging they engaged in that kind of harassment often. According to a study by the Chronicle of Higher Education, 25% of lesbian and gay students report having been harassed because of their sexual orientation, as well as a third of all transgendered students. Without question, universities must ensure equal educational opportunities for their students, and such opportunities are effectively denied in a hostile and intimidating environment. While addressing discrimination, public universities must also ensure compliance with the Constitution's guarantee of freedom of speech, which is one of our nation's bedrock values. The right to free speech undergirds our democracy and is especially critical to supporting another key role of the university, which is to foster open inquiry and the free and vigorous exchange of ideas. But restrictions on speech that seek to prohibit offensive speech can also silence First Amendment protected speech, as there is no First Amendment exception for offensive speech. Indeed, the First Amendment is supposed to protect speech that most of us find offensive because it is precisely that kind of unpopular speech that most needs protection. And we protect unpopular speech to ensure that all speech is protected and that our political debates remain robust and open. It's not enough, however, to simply say that because the Constitution makes it hard for public colleges and universities to limit speech, that they should do nothing about discrimination and harassment. Wherever there's a hate speech incident on campus, administrators and faculty have a right and duty to speak out against such bigotry. Longer term, there ought to be enhanced efforts to increase diversity in the student body and faculty at public universities. Finally, there should be ongoing education for university students and faculty on the evils of bigotry against minorities, women, and others who face harassment and discrimination based on protected characteristics. While I do not pretend that we can fully resolve the long-standing debate over hate speech and the First Amendment on public campuses during the course of this hearing, I hope we can at least have a productive discussion about the proper balance between protecting free speech and ensuring equal education opportunities for all students. Accordingly, I very much look forward to hearing the testimony from our witnesses. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And I thank the gentleman, and without objection, other members' opening statements will be made part of the record. So let me now introduce our witnesses. Our first witness is Greg Lukianoff, President and CEO of Foundation for Individual Rights in Education. He is the author of two books, Unlearning Liberty, Campus Censorship and the End of the American Debate, and Freedom from Speech. Our second witness is Kim Colby, Senior Counsel for the Christian Legal Society's Center for Law and Religious Freedom, where she worked for over 30 years to protect students' rights to meet for religious speech on college campuses. Ms. Colby has represented religious groups in several appellate cases, including two cases heard by the United States Supreme Court. Our third witness is Jamie Raskin, a state senator in Maryland and a professor of constitutional law at American University's Washington College of Law. He also taught at Yale Law School and authored several books, including We the Students, Supreme Court Cases for and About Students. Our fourth and final witness today is Wendy Kaminar, a lawyer, social critic, and freelance journalist. She is an advisor to the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education and a member of the Massachusetts State Advisory Committee to the U.S. Civil Rights Commission. We welcome you all. Now, each of the witnesses' written statements will be entered into the record in its entirety. So I would ask each of you to witness each witness that they would summarize his or her testimony in 5 minutes or less. And to help you stay within that time, there's a timing light in front of you. The light will switch from green to yellow, indicating that you have 1 minute to conclude your testimony. When the light turns red, it indicates that the witness's 5 minutes have expired. And before I recognize the witness, it is the tradition of the subcommittee that they be sworn. So if you please stand to be sworn. Do you solemnly swear that the testimony that you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? Please be seated. Let the record reflect that the witnesses answered in the affirmative. And I will now recognize our first witness, Mr. Lukianoff. Sir, please turn that microphone on if you haven't already done so. All right, thank you.
Terrific. I have a PowerPoint.
All right, we want to start the PowerPoint first?
Yeah.
Okay.
My name is Greg Lukianoff. I'm a First Amendment specialized attorney and president and CEO of the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, also known as FIRE. I'm here to testify about the serious threats to free speech and academic freedom on campus. Since I generally don't issue trigger warnings, I will go ahead and show the first slide. I show this not to shock you, but to establish that the case law protecting freedom of speech on campus is extraordinarily strong. This is a cartoon depicting police officers raping the Statue of Liberty that Supreme Court found was clearly protected speech on a public college campus. Subsequent case law has overturned virtually any attempt in higher education to ban or limit speech on the basis of its offensiveness. Nevertheless, here is a classic example of the kind of cases I deal with. In 2007, a student was found guilty of a racial harassment without so much as a hearing for publicly reading this book. The cover of the book, which ironically celebrates the defeat of the Klan, was viewed as offensive by a university employee. This incident took place at a public university, but it nonetheless took the combined efforts of FIRE, the ACLU, the Wall Street Journal to get the university to back down. And I deal with cases like this on a regular basis. But despite the strength of case law, according to FIRE's extensive research, the most extensive ever conducted into campus speech codes, we have found that 55% of them maintain codes that severely depart from First Amendment standards. Less than 2 weeks ago, this free speech zone at Blinn College in Texas, look at that, we filed a lawsuit against them. Blinn is a public college bound by the First Amendment, but when a student wanted to protest it in favor of her Second Amendment rights, she was told that she had to limit her free speech activities to this tiny zone. FIRE's research shows that nearly one out of every six universities maintain such ludicrous free speech zones. And this is despite the fact that we've been fighting these quarantines for almost our entire 15-year existence. For example, here you will see the infamous Texas Tech free speech gazebo, where back in 2003, anti-Iraq war students were told they had to limit their protests. Though these zones fail in court and in the court of public opinion, FIRE has had to file 10 lawsuits in the past year and a half, mostly dealing with these zones. And then there are the harassment-based speech codes. Here's an example from Syracuse University, where they flat-out ban offensive speech. Ooh. Anyone with a passing knowledge of the First Amendment knows that the government cannot ban speech merely because it's offensive. Nonetheless, campuses claim that federal law requires them to ban such speech. Here are some additional examples of harassment-based speech codes. And while the Department of Education had been helpful in the past by letting universities know that federal anti-discrimination law cannot be used to justify passing campus speech codes, unfortunately, in 2013, the Department of Education issued a quote-unquote blueprint to every university in the country, muddying the waters. In a settlement with the University of Montana, they defined harassment as merely unwelcome speech and explicitly rejected the reasonable person standard. While the Department of Education backed away somewhat from this being a national blueprint in a letter sent to me, they must clarify to every university in the country that federal harassment law cannot be used as a justification for unconstitutional speech codes. We propose Congress take three actions on three fronts. First, pass our Campus Anti-Harassment Act, which simply asks the federal government to provide a clear definition of actionable harassment based on the Supreme Court's holding in Davis v. Monroe County, a 1999 case dealing with peer-on-peer harassment. This single act would eliminate an entire category of the most common and tenacious and unconstitutional speech codes in a single stroke. Congress should pass a law declaring open areas on public campuses as traditional public forums, which would end absurd and tiny free speech zones while still allowing universities to apply common sense, time, place, and manner restrictions. And lastly, Congress should pass legislation making it clear that professors' free speech rights are not limited by the Garcetti v. Sabeo Supreme Court decision. I explain all of these in much greater detail in my written testimony. Across the political spectrum, I believe we all must agree that free speech belongs on our college campuses. Together, we can make sure that universities remain a true marketplace of ideas. Thank you.
And I thank you, sir. And we would now recognize our second witness, Ms. Colby, and if you make sure that microphone's on.
Chairman Franks, Ranking Member Cohen, and members of the subcommittee, I'm Kim Colby, Director of Christian Legal Society's Center for Law and Religious Freedom, where I've worked for over 30 years to protect students' rights to meet for religious speech on campus. Thank you for inviting me to testify regarding the ongoing discrimination that religious student groups experience on campuses across the country. On a typical university campus, hundreds of student groups meet to discuss political, social, and philosophical ideas. Religious student organizations enrich this marketplace of ideas. Often, the religious groups are among the more diverse student groups, drawing students from a wide range of ethnic and economic backgrounds. For 40 years, religious student groups too often have been denied their right to meet on campus. In the 1970s and 80s, many universities would invoke the Establishment Clause to justify discriminating against religious groups. But the Supreme Court ruled in 1981 and 1995 that religious groups had free speech rights to meet on campus like other student groups. After the Supreme Court removed the Establishment Clause as a justification for excluding religious groups, some university administrators began to misinterpret and misuse their university's non-discrimination policies to exclude religious groups from campus. As you saw with Bianca's interview, for the past 20 years, many colleges have told religious groups they must leave campus because it is religious discrimination for a religious group to require its leaders to agree with its religious beliefs. But it's common sense and basic religious liberty, not discrimination, for a religious group to expect its leaders to share its core religious beliefs. Non-discrimination policies are good and essential, but they are supposed to protect religious students, not drive them from campus. Properly interpreted, non-discrimination policies and students' religious liberty are eminently compatible. Universities need not misinterpret their policies, and many do not. Indeed, as a commendable best practice, some universities have embedded robust protection for religious liberty in their non-discrimination policies. I want to just mention two recent examples that illustrate the discrimination religious students too often face. In 2011, Vanderbilt University said it was religious discrimination for a Christian Legal Society student group to expect its leaders to lead its Bible study, prayer, and worship. Vanderbilt demanded that another Christian group delete 5 words from its leadership requirements if it wanted to remain on campus. Those 5 words were personal commitment to Jesus Christ. The students left campus rather than recant their core religious belief. In the end, Vanderbilt forced 14 Catholic and evangelical Christian student groups from campus. While Vanderbilt refused to allow religious groups to have religious leadership requirements, it announced that fraternities could continue to engage in sex discrimination in their selection of both leaders and members. With 437,000 students on 23 campuses, the California State University is the largest 4-year university system in the nation. This past year, Cal State withdrew recognition from many religious groups. Several had met for over 40 years on Cal State campuses with religious leadership requirements. But under a new policy, as the Cal State administrator said in the interview you heard, quote, "What they cannot be is faith-based, where someone has to have a profession of faith to be that leader," end quote. California State also applies a double standard. Fraternities can choose their leaders and members based on sex, but religious groups cannot choose their leaders based on religious belief. Our nation's colleges are at a crossroads. They can respect students' freedoms of speech, association, and religion, or they can discriminate against religious students who refuse to abandon their basic religious liberty. The road colleges choose is important, not only for the students threatened with exclusion, and not only to preserve a diversity of ideas on college campuses, but also because the lessons learned on college campuses inevitably spill over into our broader civil society. I look forward to answering your questions.
I thank the gentlelady, and I would now recognize our third witness, Mr. Raskin. And sir, if you make sure that microphone's on, okay. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Delighted to be with you. Higher education has been a critical force in advancing free inquiry in America, and as Chairman Goodlatte noted, his fellow Virginian Thomas Jefferson was a key force in defining the university as a place of secular inquiry, free from both governmental and religious compulsion and dogma and repression. It is also one of America's leading industries, higher education, and it is also, I would say, the paradigm and exemplar of free discourse and debate in our vibrant, pluralist, and multicultural democracy. So if we have no freedom of thought and speech on campus, it's hard to imagine where we are going to have it in the United States. I want to set forth 3 principles that I think should govern political speech on campus. And I should add that although the presence of state action may arguably be missing for most private colleges and universities, there's no reason that these free speech principles should not operate for private colleges and universities too, from Harvard and Yale to Southern Methodist and Oberlin and Liberty University, at least to the extent that these institutions want to think of themselves as centers of free thought and inquiry rather than centers of dogma and propaganda. And this may be the major point of difference between my perspective on these matters and my good friend Greg Lukianoff, who stands up zealously and strongly for the free speech rights of students at public universities and colleges and some private universities, but not others. I think that Liberty University, for example, should no more be able to exclude a gay student group than Harvard or Berkeley should be able to exclude an anti-gay student group. So I would defend free speech across the board, public and private, which I suppose makes me the strongest free speech absolutist here, or maybe not. I'll wait to hear from my friend Wendy Kamen or two. So the 3 principles. First, the political and social and artistic expression of students should be considered part of the educational experience rather than a detraction or diversion from it. So this means that the common areas of the university, such as the streets, the sidewalks, the greens, the commons, the cafeteria, the TV station, the radio station, the atriums, and so on, should all be treated as traditional public fora, or at least limited public fora, for the purposes of social communication and First Amendment analysis. These areas are paid for, at least substantially, by taxpayers, and they lend themselves to expressive activity and assembly of students and faculty, staff members, alumni, and indeed other members of the public. Now, of course, public expression and protest on campus must be subject, as everywhere else, to reasonable time, place, and manner restrictions. You can have your pro-choice or your pro-life rally on the campus green, but not in the hallway outside a history lecture in such a way as to make it impossible for anyone to hear the lecture proceed. This distinction permeates Supreme Court jurisprudence governing student speech. As the court wrote in the seminal Tinker versus Des Moines School District case, when a student is in the cafeteria, on the playing field, on the campus during authorized hours, he may express his opinions even on controversial subjects like the conflict in Vietnam, if he does so without materially and substantially disrupting the educational process and without colliding with the rights of other students. This has become the standard doctrine. All student speech is accepted, which does not interfere with the operation of the school and does not violate the rights of other students. And if this principle is right, the current trend of setting up free speech zones, or what students call free speech pens, is totally antithetical to free speech values. Under the First Amendment, the whole country is a free speech zone, or at least the public places within it. The doctrine of reasonable time, place, and manner restrictions presupposes that public places are open for free speech to the people and can be regulated reasonably and modestly in the interest of sleep hours, preventing scheduling conflicts, limiting the decibel level, and so on. But by sharply restricting the space and time allotted to students and citizens for expression, the free speech zone reverses all of the presumptions and makes the exception of reasonable regulation at the margins into a rule of censorship in most public places. The creation of a tiny free speech zone makes the rest of the campus a speech-free zone. This is a dangerous trend that, of course, goes beyond campus now. In the last several Democratic and Republican national conventions, there were free speech zones set up 10 or 12 blocks away from where the conventions were and where delegates were entering and exiting. Secondly, and here I echo Congressman Conyers, it's implicit in, and indeed it's integral to the Tinker standard, that freedom of speech cannot be turned into an effective cover for what the Supreme Court called in Davis versus Monroe County Board of Education, severe, pervasive, and objectively offensive harassment of students by other students or other members of the community. In that case, the court determined that Title IX is violated by such harassment, which makes it difficult, if not impossible, for the student victims to learn and to thrive. Surely we can all agree that while students and faculty can try out whatever theories they want in the classroom, they have no right to engage in personal, face-to-face, racial or sexual harassment that is so severe, pervasive, and objectively offensive that it undermines and detracts from the victim's educational experience and effectively denies them equal access to the education available at the school. This is an essential point, even if sometimes difficult to implement. My sense is that the overwhelming number of public universities and colleges know the difference between real intellectual debate and a relentless campaign of personal harassment designed to drive another student to leave the school or to commit suicide or something like that. For the sake of all of our children who go to college, it's important for the schools to recognize the difference. Now, there are, of course, some campuses where overly broad and vague speech or conduct codes have been used to target students simply for unorthodox or radical expression. And it's important to understand that a lot of these speech codes are left over from the 1960s and 70s when they were set up to target and vilify anti-war protesters and used again in the 1980s to go after the South Africa divestment anti-apartheid protesters on campus. Thousands of students were punished and disciplined during that period. To the extent that these codes are still hanging around or being used in an episodic or idiosyncratic way to go after people for speech that others determine to be offensive or experiences offensive, then those codes should indeed be restricted and shut down for that impermissible application. And they should be forced to conform to the First Amendment. Finally, when it comes to faculty, administrators may not treat their academic research and inquiry and speech as government speech, which can be regulated by the administrators. Academic speech, as the Fourth Circuit found in a 2011 case, combines whatever public prestige or authority there is to the university with the private citizen expression and ideas of the professor. And so that has to be protected. And finally, let me just say one thing about Ms. Colby's testimony, if I could, and the Fox News segment we saw. The Supreme Court has ruled on this question in Christian Legal Society versus Martinez in 2010, where the court upheld Hastings' so-called all-comers policy, saying that that policy said any group can operate on campus, but if you want to be recognized by campus and by the university and get money and use the official email system, you've got to be open to all comers, to all students who want to join. And the majority on the court, including Justice Kennedy, upheld that policy as being viewpoint neutral and upheld it as promoting academic discourse and free discussion on campus. And so, you know, I think that the alternative position is one that would actually lead to more censorship. Imagine if one faction seizes hold of the Christian Legal Society and says, we don't think that Mormons are Christians and they can't belong here. And you sign an oath saying that you believe that Mormonism is antithetical to Christianity. Well, the position of saying whoever gets there first gets to define the code and the constitution of the group would lead to just that kind of race into the campus door to seize control of the group and say, we are the real Christians. The way the Supreme Court upheld it is simply to say anybody can join, anybody's got the right to participate in the democratic dialogue and discussion and elections. And I think that is the libertarian and the democratic approach.
And I thank the gentleman. And I would now recognize our fourth and final witness, Ms. Kaminar, and make sure that microphone's on, okay? Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for inviting me to testify. I'm Wendy Kaminer. I'm a writer, a lawyer, and a free speech feminist. That is not an oxymoron. I have been following, participating in, and occasionally provoking free speech battles on and off campus for decades. While the legality of censorship at public and private institutions differs dramatically, the culture of censorship is virtually the same. I hope to offer an understanding of that culture. You've seen a few typically extreme examples of it. For now, I will simply note that these days when students talk about feeling safe, they're often talking about feeling protected from what one campus newspaper called being attacked by viewpoints. How did opposing viewpoints become so fearful? The impulse to censor is a nonpartisan vice, but I will focus on the roots of progressive censorship campaigns, which are largely responsible for restrictive speech codes on campus and Department of Education policies. On the left, censorship is an extension of the drive for civil rights. It equates words with actions and insists that equality requires policing offensive words or microaggressions. Now, new technologies obviously have played a role in increasing anxieties about speech. But this essential view of pure speech as active discrimination partly reflects the confluence of three popular movements that date back some 30 years. Feminist anti-porn crusades of the 1980s, late 20th century personal development fads, and multiculturalism, which accompanied a commendable drive for diversity on campus. In the 1980s, law professor and the late writer Andrea Dworkin popularized what became a highly influential view of speech as a substantial bar to equality. They denied the difference between words and action, framing pornography as an actual sexual assault and a civil rights violation. They persuaded Indianapolis to adopt a model civil rights anti-porn ordinance, which was soon struck down by the Seventh Circuit. So McKinnon and Dworkin lost that battle, but their successors are winning the war. Campus speech codes reflect their view of presumptively bad speech as discrimination. Equating offensive speech with harmful actions was also at the center of 1980 personal development movements that focused on recovery from verbal abuse and the supposed disease of codependency. Pop psychologists declared that virtually all of us were victims of child abuse, which was defined very broadly to include being chastised occasionally by your parents. Consequently, virtually all of us were said to be fragile, easily damaged by unwelcome speech. This made censorship seem only humane. It made censorship seem a moral necessity as well as an essential path to equality. These ideas were readily absorbed on campuses concerned with diversity. Multiculturalists sought to protect students deemed historically disadvantaged from offensive speech. Like abuse, discrimination, and even oppression were defined down to include feeling offended, demeaned, or insulted by attitudes and remarks. Offensiveness, and I think this is really important, offensiveness was defined by the unpredictable subjective responses of listeners who belong to protected classes. So it's not surprising that many students report being harassed. The question is, what do they mean by being harassed? They may mean they've been offended or attacked by viewpoints. Campus censorship, like Western European bans on hate speech, establishes a right of particular audiences not to be offended at the expense of a universal right to speak. And what happens on campus doesn't stay on campus. Students graduate. They become faculty, administrator, government regulators. Because speech restrictions date back decades now, some middle-aged policymakers as well as students support and promulgate bans on whatever they deem discriminatory speech. So as you consider censorship on public campuses, consider the possible far-reaching consequences of producing generations of potential censors. American constitutional guarantees of free speech established in the 20th century may not survive the 21st. We may go the way of Western Europe in banning whatever is considered hateful speech. What can Congress do to arrest and perhaps reverse these campus trends? It can monitor the Department of Education, which seems out of control. The case of Northwestern professor Laura Kipnis, who's been investigated for publishing unfashionable opinions about sexual politics on campus, exemplifies the department's overreach. It can also consider enacting the kind of affirmative protections on speech that the Foundation for Individual Rights of Education has proposed. But perhaps the most important thing for Congress to do legislatively is not very much. Don't react to bad speech by enacting bad laws that confuse offensive words with discriminatory action. Freedom of speech is freedom from government interference. It depends on official inaction. Now, if I may, just as a quick postscript, I'd like to comment on Professor Raskin's comment about Liberty University. I think that in trying to impose First Amendment protections on a private religious institution, he is, I suppose, giving them First Amendment rights, but at the expense of the First Amendment speech rights, at the expense of their First Amendment associational rights. Thank you.
Well, thank you all for your testimony. We will now proceed under the five-minute rule with questions, and I will begin by recognizing myself for 5 minutes. Mr. Lukianoff, I guess my first question to you, sir, against incidentally, your testimony is very compelling. How prevalent are speech zone policies in our nation's public universities and colleges, and what is the, for the record, what is the rationale for quarantining free speech expression to one specific area on campus? What's the legal foundation for it?
Well, we do very extensive research, and as best we can tell, it's about 1/6 of universities, and we survey around 437 universities, and we usually prefer the ones that are the biggest universities, so that 437 ends up bringing in a lot of the biggest schools in the country as well. About 1/6 of them have speech zones that we think are, to use an easy way to say it, laughably unconstitutional. And every time we've challenged them, whether in the court of law or just naming them a speech code of the month, they generally drop the zones. But nonetheless, we've been fighting these for 15 years. Part of the rationale, well, I'm not totally clear on what the rationale is. I think Jamie is right, that Professor Raskin is right, that since these were probably started up in the 60s as of what was presumed to be a positive thing, as an additional place where you could always engage in free speech, and then at some point they became the only place you could engage in free speech, thereby quarantining 99.9% of campus from meaningful speech and protest. I think that's because with the mass expansion of the bureaucracy on college campuses, you end up with administrators really frankly preferring, and sometimes it's not ideological at all, they just want peace and quiet. They don't really get the chaotic paradise that our universities are supposed to be. They'd really rather, you know, if you have something to say that's controversial, frankly, it's more convenient if you get advanced permission. Oh, and I should emphasize, in a lot of these cases, they're not just free speech zones. They're free speech zones that you have to apply 10 days in advance to use. That you want to hand out flyers that might upset somebody, it's better you do it in the corner over there. So I think it's partially peace and quiet on campus. I think partially it's mass bureaucratization. And I think there are people on campus who would rather nobody say anything at all, at least nothing near anyone, rather than have anyone offended.
Well, thank you, sir. And Ms. Kaminar, I found your testimony particularly compelling. And I would like to just pose the notion to you, are pro-censorship attitudes from campus areas, are they spreading beyond campuses? And if so, to what extent and what ways?
Oh, absolutely. We've seen a few recent examples of it. We saw the reaction of many commentators in the press, from Fox News to the New York Times editorial page, to the attacks on the Draw Mohammed contest that was organized by Pam Geller in Texas. A lot of journalists blamed Pamela Geller for essentially inciting the violence instead of blaming the people who engaged in it. Without expressing an opinion on the niceness or the integrity or the appropriateness of what Geller was trying to do, there's no question that she had an absolute right to do it, and that we should not hold people who engage in protected speech, regardless of how provocative, responsible for violent acts committed in reaction to it. That's just one obvious example. But I think that if you go into the general population, you'll hear many people say things like, I'm not in favor of censorship, but free speech isn't hate speech. That's a very common sentiment. It's also a somewhat nonsensical one, because as Congressman Conyers had said, free speech is supposed to protect unpopular speech, speech that some people consider hateful. Otherwise, free speech guarantees are completely redundant.
Yes, ma'am. Ms. Colby, I'm troubled by the double standard that colleges seem to be applying when the fraternities choose their leaders and members based on sex or gender, and it occurs to me that you made that point very strongly in your comments. But then they, of course, refuse to allow religious groups to choose their leaders based on religious beliefs.
Right.
And I mean, I think it's very appropriate for colleges to allow fraternities to choose their leaders and members as they've always done. But why not allow religious groups to do the same? Why the double standard? Again, I'm getting you to, you're sort of being redundant in your comments previously, but.
Well, I think the reason for the double standard is that the fraternities and sororities are a much more powerful constituency on and off campus than the religious groups are. And so the universities don't tend to want to restrict them, but they think that they can go ahead with the religious groups. But I just wanted to, these exceptions for the fraternities and sororities goes to Professor Raskin's point about what was actually the holding in CLS v. Martinez. In CLS v. Martinez, the court was very specific. It actually went on for about three pages about the fact that it was not deciding the issue of whether non-discrimination policies could be used to prohibit religious groups from having religious leadership requirements. That's an issue that has not been decided by the Supreme Court. Instead, what the court said, what Justice Ginsburg said in her opinion, is we're focusing on this very narrow policy that Hastings College of Law had, which was that all groups had to be open to all comers. But the court was very clear in its holding that universities don't have to have such policies. There was even a question whether they are good policies. But furthermore, that if they have an all-comers policy, it has to apply to all groups. So Hastings College of Law didn't have a problem doing that. It had very few student groups compared to your normal public university. But any public university that has fraternities and sororities really cannot apply an all-comers policy. And so that's why this issue of how non-discrimination policies should be applied to religious groups is very much a live one on campuses, because as long as universities have these fraternities and sororities and they create these exceptions for them, keep this double standard. They don't have an all-comers policy, and they have to treat the religious groups the way they are, the fraternities and sororities.
I understand. All right, with that, I would now yield to the ranking member for 5 minutes for his questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ms. Colby, I'd like to ask you about your statements concerning Vanderbilt University.
Yes.
Are you aware of the fact that Vanderbilt requires groups to get university approval and use the university name and be eligible for university funding and other university benefits to simply allow all students to be a member of the organization? It doesn't say who can be the head of the organization. Anybody can be the head, and if it's the Baptist students group, they could elect a Baptist, they could elect a Muslim, they could elect a Presbyterian, they could elect whoever they wanted, but they can't not allow somebody to ask for membership and to be a member of a university authorized benefited group. Is that how you understand the situation at Vanderbilt?
Well, what I understand is that at Vanderbilt, they specifically say that they don't allow religious groups to have faith requirements for their leaders, and that is their policy.
I believe it may be, and I don't know that for a fact, the groups elect the leaders, and the groups can elect anybody they want. And now if you have a clause that says you can't be the leader unless you think X, then you are putting a factor over the election that doesn't make it a democratic process, because the majority might want to elect somebody who doesn't believe in X. And if that's the case, then I guess they should change their bylaws, but it simply leaves up to the group the decision of who's going to be the head of the group, and the group makes that decision, and that's democracy. And that seems like something that should be applied in religious groups and non-religious groups. And I think there are 13 different religious groups that have gone through and accept and abide by as 460 other groups at Vanderbilt that are part of the Vanderbilt University extracurricular social blah 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 groups.
So another thing that Vanderbilt says is that the Democratic Club has to allow Republicans to be leaders if they get elected.
And if they get elected, it becomes that.
But then how is it the Democratic Club? So it's always been the practice of groups that deal with social or political, philosophical or religious ideas, groups that form around ideas, have constitutions that say our leaders have to agree with our ideas. And that's how the group from year to year maintains its identity. And so it's just very strange. It's actually an elimination of freedom of association for all of these groups when you adopt an all-comers policy like Vanderbilt tried to do, to say to groups, you can't define yourself around beliefs, whether they're political beliefs.
And I don't know if they do or don't, but I'd say this. First, what you said about Democrat, that they make Republicans be a member. If the Republicans outvote them, that happened, let's say, Indiana. Mr. Lugar, great senator, fine Republican, lost to a Tea Party guy. My buddy Joe Donnelly's now the senator. What happens? The Republicans pick the wrong guy. Lugar probably would have won. They picked the other guy. Donnelly won. It's democracy. If the Republicans infiltrate the Democrats and elect it, it becomes the mugwump party. But that's part of democracy. And as far as, you know, Vanderbilt, you know, you picked a bad subject with me. I'm a Vanderbilt graduate. I was Mr. Commodore at Vanderbilt. We're going to win the NCAA baseball championship again. We're looking at Illinois on Saturday. Good stuff happening there. Vanderbilt has long been a citadel of progressive and open policies in the South, a leader in universities and in other, you know, institutions in the South as being forward. Bringing Stokely Carmichael to speak in the 60s when people didn't maybe appreciate that, and they, a lot didn't, but they brought Stokely Carmichael to speak on campus, as did Julian Bond when I was there, and Robert Kennedy. Vanderbilt has long been a citadel of open thought and openness, and that's why the non-discrimination policy is important. And, you know, I remember the Baptist Student Union when I was there. I didn't go to join the Baptist Student Union, but I went to the Baptist Student Union some, and if I would have joined and they'd elected me president of the Baptist Student Union, you know, it would have been kumbaya. That wouldn't have been bad, because it would have been the decision of the Baptist Student Union. And we're all here up in Congress because we were elected by our constituents, the ones that showed up and voted. And if it so happens that people show up and vote and elect somebody else, it doesn't say you have to elect somebody of the same faith.
Well, in the past, until 2011, Vanderbilt had always allowed religious groups and other political groups and other thought groups to define themselves by what their thoughts were, and to say, this is, if you're our leader, you have to agree with these basic beliefs. And then Vanderbilt, it just changed course. But I think you've put your finger on one of the reasons that all comers policies are particularly a threat to smaller groups on campus, because they do then have a problem with maintaining their identity if they're a minority group on campus, because if someone decides that they don't like that group, it's becoming too pesky, they don't like the pro-life group's position, say, they can go in and change what that group's message is for that particular year. And that's really a threat to free speech across the board.
All they have to do is give up their right to money from the Vanderbilt University and the right to use Vanderbilt University as a titled group. And if they want to give that up, that's fine. But it's part of society, and it's a part of law and a part of life, and it's tough. Vanderbilt's not always been perfect. Listen, I'm going to tell you that. When I went to school there, Jews were not allowed in any fraternity. And when you went through Rush, you were told, you're going to love being a Zeb or an AE Pi. Those were the Jewish fraternities. And it was like, you go there. Mm-hmm. And you went to the non-Jewish fraternities sanctioned by the university, and they said, oh, you're going to love being a Zeb. Hadn't felt that in my life. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, it was there. Now, the Zeb house, there are no Jews in the Zeb house. They've gone, like you said. You know, but it's still ZBT. It's kind of weird, but that's the way it is.
And what you're saying is religious discrimination, right? There's no reason there should be a fraternity that limits its members.
That was 1969.
But when it comes to a religious group defining itself by its religious beliefs, then it's not religious discrimination. It's actually religious liberty.
But they're not discriminating. They're just saying you have to allow every, if you're going to be a Vanderbilt University Baptist X or Christian X, you have to allow any Vanderbilt student to join, and they get to run for office. And if they win, they win.
Well, what they're really saying is every Christian group has to be a Unitarian group. They can't really have specific creedal requirements. And that's not fair to the evangelical Christian groups who do define themselves by their beliefs. And also, Vanderbilt always said it was just withholding the name and the funds, but that recognition brings with it the right to free meeting space on campus,
right,
and access to channels of communication, which are essential to a group. But I noticed you were a Vanderbilt grad, and I have never met better students than the Vanderbilt student body. They are incredible students, and I'm sure they were when you were there too.
Thank you.
They are incredible now.
Thank you.
Now, thank the gentleman. I guess sometimes, you know, it occurs to me that if we allowed the Republicans to vote in the Democrat primary, that we might nominate some pretty unique people for you. And perhaps if we, in the interest of broad-mindedness, allowed our friends in China to vote in the presidential election, we might come up with a different situation here. So we got to kind of keep an eye on where we're going here, don't we? And with that, I would now recognize the gentleman from Texas for his 5 minutes, Mr. Gohmert.
Thank you, and I appreciate the 8 minutes I'm going to get as well. I went to Texas A&M, and it was a very conservative public university. I was very involved in student activities, including the Student Center. I had so many different groups, and back then, as conservative as we were, we had no fear of inviting very liberal speakers. I really enjoyed Ralph Nader, helping host Ralph Nader. Didn't agree with him on much, but really enjoyed the questions, and he was open to any questions, and he listened to us. It was one of the better programs, even though I didn't agree with it much. But, of course, nowadays, since the intellectual elite liberals have taken over more of the college campuses, a conservative like me is not particularly welcome to come speak on college campuses. So times have changed. The liberals, as they've taken over, have become perhaps some of the most intolerant folks. And I appreciate what was just said. It seems that now we've devolved to a standard where you can have your religious beliefs so long as we agree with them. But if we don't agree with them, then you're going to fund all of the groups on campus through your fees and your money, and they're going to get up and say things about how terrible you are, particularly if you're a Christian group, because, you know, in this realm of political correctness, the only group that it's okay to be totally politically intolerant toward are Christians. And we had some of this discussion. I pointed out someday when we were talking about hate crime, someday somebody's going to say Christianity is a hateful religion because these people believe what Jesus said, that he was the way, the truth, and the life, and nobody could go to heaven but through him. So therefore, it's hateful to anybody they're saying can't go to heaven except through Jesus. And they've totally lost the founding of the country. When you found a country on democracy that just, you know, what a majority votes and says will carry the day, then you're ultimately going to, again, devolve into a situation where might makes right, and pilgrims will leave this country to go find one where, once again, they won't be discriminated against, which is why they came here. But when you look at the First Amendment, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or the press or the right of the people to peaceably assemble. So what we see on some of our college campuses is an extreme abridgment of the freedom to assemble. Yeah, you can assemble off campus. We're going to take all your fees. We're going to fund these people that hate your guts and think you're crazy as Christians, but you have the right to assemble off campus. It is so entirely unfair and truly un-American. When I look at Thomas Jefferson's comment, it's part of the Jefferson Memorial. God, who gave us life, gave us liberty. Can the liberties of a nation be secured when we have removed a conviction that these liberties are the gift of God? Indeed, I tremble for my country when I reflect that God is just, that his justice cannot sleep forever. It just seems that at this point in time, we have been overtaken by the thought that we cannot base our beliefs on the idea that freedom is a gift from God, but it, like any gift, it requires defense. You got FDR on D-Day praying for several minutes, "Help us, Almighty God, to rededicate ourselves in renewed faith in Thee in this hour of great sacrifice. And, O Lord, give us faith in Thee." What, and people didn't get upset with that. They were okay with prayer going to God. But as C.S. Lewis said, you know, when he was an atheist and agnostic, he loved to chide Christians. How can there be so much injustice and there be a just God? And, well, that's well and good, but wouldn't it be easier to just say there can't be a just God? And then one day he realized he could never know what was just or that there was any injustice unless there was some unwavering, eternal standard of justice and injustice. Otherwise, you could never know there was injustice, just like a person that's been blind all their lives could never know whether there was light or dark. Nobody gets it right, as he said. Just because some people can't hit the notes doesn't mean the music's not beautiful. So anyway, I realize I haven't gotten to a question, but I'm just quite concerned, and I appreciate actually all of your efforts on behalf of free speech. and I look forward to the day when we won't hate anybody. We can be like my family was growing up. We can fuss, we can argue, but we still love each other at the end of the day. But thank you for your work. Really appreciate your stands for free speech. Thank you.
So true tolerance is not in pretending you have no differences. It's being kind and loving to each other like family in spite of those differences, right? And with that, Mr. Chairman, I would now recognize the ranking member, Mr. Conyers, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like each of you to, starting with Senator Jamie Raskin, to tell me what main thing you have gotten out of this open discussion with each other, and any other anything else you'd like to contribute to your feelings about the hearing itself today. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Congressman, and thank you for your passionate advocacy on behalf of freedom of expression and civil liberties and civil rights for your whole career. I would say to Congressman Gohmert, I agreed very much with a lot of what I heard, but when he said that he does not feel welcome at a lot of universities or colleges, I want to issue an invitation to you right now to come to American University, and I think we would benefit a lot from your views, and so I hope we could work.
Actually, I've been there and spoken before. Thank you.
Okay, well, you're welcome to come back. So, yeah, you've not been banned from campus. Congressman, I was very interested, I was fascinated by the colloquy between Congressman Cohen and Ms. Colby about Vanderbilt, having just read the book about my colleague at AU Law School, Perry Wallace, who is a great basketball player at Vanderbilt and experienced just, you know, dreadful, intense racism at many different points in his career as the first African-American basketball player in that conference. The specific doctrinal dispute between the two of you was over the provision which says the groups have to be open to everybody. And obviously, that has an historical context where much of the academic civil society life, if you will, at Vanderbilt and many colleges throughout the South and beyond the South and the rest of the country were segregated by race, by religion, as you suggest. And the universities, the Supreme Court said in the Martinez decision, have an academic freedom interest in trying to promote real social interaction. And that doesn't mean agreement, it doesn't mean ideological conformity, but getting students who come to college for the first time, often leaving a community of whatever type where they've been used to just one set of views or one set of people, to have the freedom at least to go and check out the Republican Club if they've always been in a Democratic community. Or as you were saying, if you grew up in a Jewish community, check out the Baptist group. And you can't be excluded at the door simply because you don't sign a loyalty oath on the way in. So there's a positive value there in promoting the all-comers policy. Not every university or college has to do it. Ms. Colby's right, the Supreme Court didn't say it's First Amendment compulsory, but certainly the colleges that want to promote a liberal arts integrative experience can go ahead and do it. But let me say that there is, this goes beyond religion. We're making it seem as if it's about religion. This is about politics, too. I mean, my group could get into the Democratic Club before the other kids show up, or while they're off at bowling night or something, and we say, if you want to belong to the Democratic Club, you've got to come out against the TPP, or you've got to come out for the TPP, and if you don't sign on the way in, you're no longer a member of the Democratic Club. The people could get in and take over the Republican Club, the first people to arrive on campus the day before everybody else, and say, if you want to belong in the Republican Club, you've got to sign off on the Tea Party philosophy, and if you don't, you don't belong in the Republican Club. Now you've got the university trying to mediate and litigate, adjudicate all these disputes between different factions, as opposed to what you're suggesting, which is the democratic way, which is the doors are open, everybody goes in, and you participate, and you democratically elect them. If you don't like what the group ends up standing for, you've got the right, not just of voice, but of exit, and you go and create a new group. And I think that's a lot more like what civil society in a robust, pluralistic, democratic society is all about.
Thank you. You used up all my time. Yes, I'll yield to you.
Thank you. I want to thank you for asking Mr. Raskin to respond. He did an outstanding job in really capsulizing the issue, and that is it, and bringing up Perry Wallace. Perry was the first African-American to play in the Southeastern Conference, and Vanderbilt integrated the SEC. And the book's a great book, and he was my view scepter when I went to Vanderbilt, my person to kind of lead me and orient me as a freshman. But much of the discrimination he got was, it was everywhere, but it was a lot of it was in campuses around when he went on road games. But it wasn't perfect at Vanderbilt either, but it's become much better. Thank you, Mr. Conyers.
You're more than welcome. And I want to thank all the witnesses for making this very stimulating. And I want to thank especially the chairman of the subcommittee, because I think we see that with other witnesses, this can continue to grow in terms of the understanding of what goes on in terms of trying to see and appreciate the differences in the kind of policies that may look the same on the surface. So I thank all the witnesses.
Well, let me just express the same sentiments in return, Mr. Ranking Member. And I suppose any people whose search is for the truth would recognize that the surest way to get there is with the free exchange of ideas, and we should not be afraid of that. And I can't express to you what, again, an encouraging hearing this has been for me. It gives me hope, and I thank all of you. I know that there are some differences in certain areas, but that's kind of why we're all here. But the commonality here this morning for me was very encouraging, and this includes today's hearing. And I want to thank all of our witnesses for attending and all of our audience for attending. And without objection, all members will have 5 legislative days to submit additional written questions for the witnesses or additional materials for the record. And again, I thank the witnesses, I thank the members and the audience, and this hearing is adjourned.
You think? I was talking fast. I left out a lot, but I was trying to stay within my time limit.